Welcome to Rick's Corner. I have a man here today who is a publisher. He was a bodybuilder. He worked out at World Gym and Gold's, but World Gym back in the 80s with all the champions that we knew of back then. And we met on a chance that he'll tell you. He saw my show and I had a book and he wanted to publish my book, but it wasn't updated. But his name is Rick Newcombe. He has a publishing company. He's been around a long time in the publishing world with a lot of big names, haven't you?
I have. I founded Creator Syndicate, which is probably the third largest syndication company in the world, and we've represented everyone from Ann Landers to Hunter Thompson to Bill O'Reilly to Hillary Clinton. We negotiated with Donald Trump for a contract, though we couldn't quite reach terms, but it's been a very successful publishing and syndication company.
Well, before we get off on something else, I want to just say to the viewers out there, there's a lot of you guys out there who write to me, and a few of you have written books and you're working on your chapters and you want to put them together. What would you suggest for somebody who's written a book? What should they do with it?
Oh, I think they should send me a note. I'll have it sent to our editorial board for review.
Okay.
Because I'm really interested in bodybuilding and weightlifting books.
Okay. You guys hear that? So if you want that information, just get to me and I'll get it to you.
It's a subcategory. We have Rick's book. We're publishing as what we're doing is ebooks, mostly Kindle and Nook and iTunes books and Google books, and we're doing all of Franco Columbo's old books that are out of print that were huge sellers, and one of them sold 500,000 copies, and now we're publishing it as ebooks. This is like his memoirs, Coming On Strong, Winning Bodybuilding. So I think there's an encyclopedia for bodybuilders.
Mm-hmm.
Jackson Yee is a bodybuilder. We did his book. Joe Weider, and he wrote a column for Creator Syndicate. We published those columns as a book. So it's a category I'm very interested in. So send them to me. Or send them to Rick and he'll forward them.
I'll do that. Nowadays, most of the books are downloads, aren't they?
I would say digital publishing is certainly the wave of the future.
Yeah. Yes. What about those people who want hard copies so they can autograph them and sign them to people? It's quite a bit of an investment.
Right, it is. And you can still get, through Amazon, you can get publishing on demand. And we are doing that with Franco's books.
So I've seen it. Is the quality good, though?
Yeah, the quality's okay.
It's not like done on just like a printer with like 8x10 paper?
No, it looks like a real book, a paperback.
Okay. That might be a way to go for some people.
Yeah, absolutely.
Because they want to buy it, they want you to sign it. You know, it's hard to do on a Kindle, of course.
Right.
All right, so you contacted me.
Yes, I did.
Because I'm so handsome and sexy looking, and you thought you could make money off me.
What happened was, Jackie was somebody, this goes back to the 80s, he was a student at USC.
Right.
And I was working out with Mike Myers at World Gym,
mm-hmm.
and also with Bertel Fox. Bertel, Mike, and I trained together for about 2.5 years. 6 days a week. It was amazing experience. I can tell you about it. But anyway, Jack and I became friends, and he contacted me a year or two ago and said, I'm in Massachusetts. He's a school teacher, and he wanted to know, are you still bodybuilding? I said, oh yeah, I'm 67. I'm 67 going on 37 because of the weightlifting.
And yeah.
And what you'll see in Rick's book, the whole mind-body connection, that's the key to a happy life. And Jack said, we were talking about Bertel, and I said, what a tragedy, because he killed two people and is right. In prison in St. Kitts for life. And I said, there's a documentary on YouTube that came out of Ireland that's really interesting. Have you seen it? And he said, no. So I sent him a link. And then he sent me a link. He said, have you seen this interview with Eddie Giuliani? Because we all knew Eddie. He was a great guy.
Oh, wonderful guy.
Saw him every day at World Gym. Great sense of humor, a tremendous discipline, worked very hard, consistent. And I was enthralled, Rick's interviews with Eddie. And then I started looking at other interviews, Leroy Colbert, Joe Weider, and I was just really impressed. I thought, who is this guy? This is fantastic. I don't remember you from World Gym, and I remembered everybody. But then when I've seen pictures of you then, I do remember.
Yeah, it was a different look. You know, I had hair and all that. But you had said you had seen a copy, was it Strength and Health?
Yeah.
And you wanted to look like that.
Oh, yeah.
We're going to put that up because he had a bodybuilding picture with that. That was his motivation. And I think we've all done that. We've all looked at bodybuilders. I used to look at Bill Pearl and say, okay, or Larry Scott, I want to have a body like that.
Right.
You have to have some inspiration and motivation, and you have to have a vision to see where you want to be, and then you'll be your own person once you get there.
That's right. That's right. So after I saw the YouTubes, the Rick's Corner, I sent you an email. It said, I think you're doing bodybuilding a tremendous service because you're creating this visual library forever about bodybuilding. Yeah. You're capturing what happened then and now, and it's just fantastic. And I said, we're starting this book publishing company. We're focused on digital books, ebooks. Would you be interested? I know you write for the Huffington Post. Maybe we could take a collection of those columns and publish them as a book. And you said, well, you know, to tell you the truth, I've written my memoirs, and I'm really interested in getting those published. And I said, well, tell me about that. And then you said, well, I stopped in 2000. So you then said, I'm going to write an update. For the final chapter will be 2000 until today and what's going on. And you sent me the whole thing as a PDF. I read it. I was enthralled. I said, oh, my gosh, we got to publish this. So we assigned an editor to work with Rick. And yeah, here we are.
Well, I wrote that when, in 2001. I tore both my quads and I was down for the count. I mean, both legs had to be reattached, or not legs, but quads. And I was in a wheelchair for 6 weeks with leg braces. And I started sitting here thinking that my world's coming to an end. And I'm not like that. I'm not like that at all. I'm very focused and positive. But I thought, well, I got to do something while I'm down. So I wrote a book. And I wrote a book up to that time of 2001. What was going on with my life? When you said, what's it dated to? I said, well, I got to bring it forward to 2017.
Right.
Which I can do, but it's going to take me a little bit of time because there's so many things that happened in life, in my life, from then till now, that I had to recall everything I've done. I'm pretty good about it. I know where I've been and who I've seen and what I've done. So when I put it together, it kind of finished it up.
Right.
And we got to go from 2017 to when I'm 120. That'll come later.
You know, what I love, you know, one thing you do extremely well is you pick great titles. Like Barbells for Dumbbells. I mean, that's like a brilliant title.
Well, it's hard. You know, you sit and think of something. I used to always look at TV Guide, and they call them log lines. There's a show on TV. Can you tell us what that show's about in one line? And it's difficult because it could be about a dozen things, but you got to find out really what it means to somebody who looks at it and say, well, I want to see what that is, because those key words are what's going to bring it forward, right?
Right, right.
So Bodybuilding for Dumbbells, I was thinking there's all these books, the
for dummies.
Typing for Dummies. You can't use it because it's trademarked.
Right.
But
no,
dumbbells and dummies.
It's
and
perfect.
Yeah, it's perfect.
It's perfect.
It's perfect.
In fact, we should publish that as an ebook.
I think so, too.
But in any event, when I saw the title of your story, The Time of My Life, it's
right.
Perfect. Again,
yeah.
Great title.
Well, because I had the time of my life. How was your life? I said, I had the time of my life. Everything I've done, you know, it's like everything I've done in my life. Someone asked me today, or yesterday, I got off an elevator in Beverly Hills going to my skin doctor, and some girl says, are you a wrestler? I said, well, I used to be. She says, well, I see your tattoos, and I saw your wrestling shirt. I said, yeah, did you enjoy it? I said, I had the time of my life. I said, if I had to go back and do it all over, I'd do it all over again. I wouldn't even hesitate.
Yeah?
The thing that I regret mostly is back in the 80s and even the 70s and 80s, is that, well, maybe the 80s had them, but the 70s didn't have video cameras.
Yeah.
There was nothing. Tommy Chong loaned me a camera one day. It was on those big RCAs, big heavy thing. And you can't walk around. You got to carry a side pack and all that. But if I would have had that in the gym, with all the characters that we had back at World Gym,
right,
that were originally at Gold's Gym, we could have done a whole thing on these people, because there's nothing like them today.
Right, right.
Those guys don't exist. The only one, a few that do, is like Eddie Giuliani, for example. Yeah. He's still 80-something. He's at the gym at 5 o'clock every morning.
I know. He's so disciplined.
So disciplined. He's still got that funny personality, that right. New York, Brooklyn accent, and his right. attitude. He's just great. And those guys like that are few and far between.
I remember Tommy Chong. One time we did calves together. It was mm-hmm. a Sunday at World Gym, Sunday morning, and I was doing calves, and he came over and said, I was resting between sets, and he said, excuse me, can I work in? I said, sure.
So, it was a great guy.
Great
guy. He had a big Rolls Royce and a license plate that said Humble. But he, a very giving person, just one of the guys, typical hippie on the beach. But, you know, you saw a lot of people come in and out of World Gym, like Richard Jekyll.
Yes, I knew Richard. He explained to me the difference between a feature film and a video and a television. He was a great guy. And then, you know, in my other business, in Creator Syndicate, we syndicate BC and Wizard of Id, the comic strips. And Johnny Hart is the cartoonist who does BC. And every year there's a BC Open in those days. It was part of the PGA Tour. And one year, Richard Jekyll's son was
yes.
a professional golfer at a BC Open, and I had just come back. And I was talking to Richard Jekyll. He said, where you been? I said, I was up in Binghamton, New York, or Endicott, New York, at the BC Open. He said, oh my gosh, my son was golfing in that. So if I'd only know.
Well, if you guys don't know who he is, if you ever saw the movie The Dirty Dozen, mm-hmm. Richard was the sergeant that was in charge of all the bad guys. Short guy, blonde hair, nice looking guy. When he was 50, he looked 30.
Yeah.
He never aged. He did a ton of movies, up for Academy Awards. And he was just one of the regular guys down at World Gym. I had some surgery once, and he he calls my house and asks my wife at the time, he says, I want to speak to Rick. She says, who's this? He says, this is Joe Weider. I thought it was, you know, because Joe would call me from time to time. It was him just checking on me. He was just that type of guy.
He was.
But we had good characters back then.
Great characters. I got to tell you, I remember when I first joined World Gym, it was, let me back up. In the early 60s, when I was 12 years old, I bought my first Strength and Health, and I said, oh, I've got to look like this guy. It was a Frenchman named Guy Mirzik. We would say Guy, G-U-Y, Mirzik. Mm-hmm. And he was Mr. France, and he competed in Mr. Universe. And this picture in Strength and Health was what I wanted. Mm-hmm. And for about 3 years, from 12, 13, 14, I really worked out hard, and I got to know Rock Stonewall. I worked out at Triumph Gym on Van Buren Street in Chicago, which had been Irwin Johnson's apartment. And he moved out here and called himself Rio Blair. And this was Triumph Gym in Chicago, Rock Stonewall. I was like 13 years old. So, but then at some point in high school, I started, you know, just playing sports, soccer and swimming and whatever. And in college, all I did was walk. And I just got into academics, and I really focused on that. I went to Georgetown University, went through in 3 years, graduated Phi Beta Kappa, magna cum laude, went to University of Chicago School of Business for a while, and was totally, and then I had founded a newspaper at Georgetown that still exists today, the Georgetown Voice. But by age 28, I was working now for UPI as a reporter and editor. And I had gotten fat and out of shape. You know, I thought, what's going on? And I was smoking very heavily, cigarettes, and drinking a lot. And I'm sitting in the UPI bureau in Baltimore. And I get a press release from Simon & Schuster saying Arnold Schwarzenegger has a biography or autobiography, mm-hmm. and wants to come and be interviewed to promote it. So I immediately called New York and said, oh yeah, I'll interview him. I look forward to this. So Arnold came to Baltimore. We met at a Hilton Hotel in downtown Baltimore. I remember he walked in, it was winter, and so he had a tweed jacket and a turtleneck. And he looked like Frankenstein to me, because I wasn't used to it. I hadn't been around bodybuilders for a long time.
So big.
And I was so inspired, and I thought, why did I give this up? I want to get back to it. So then when coincidentally, I got hired by the LA Times, so we moved here. And I decided, you know, I'm 30 years old. I'm too old to do trial and error in the gym. I need the best program. And I was looking at Muscle and Fitness, and I saw an ad by Franco Columbo, bodybuilding. And I was in Santa Monica. He was in Westwood. That's only like 2 miles apart. I made an appointment, saw Franco, and have been training ever since.
It's funny that you say that, because when I was younger, I trained every day, and then I went to the Army, and I had several months off of basic training. I said, all this time off, I could have been training, been better. But they had a gym on post, so I started going there again. When I got out, I went right back to the gym. I always thought that time off was just going to hold me back so far. Although sometimes you need time off just to recover, and not a lot of time, I mean like 3 or 4 days, maybe a week, not any more than that. But you get into 2 or 3 months, I've seen people do this over here, and they fall apart, and they don't want to come back, they get lazy, and it's very difficult.
Yeah. Do you know that Franco actually recommends, if you're doing a heavy weightlifting routine, every 3 months take 1 week off.
Yeah.
Do a lot of walking, and watch your diet week. But then go back to the training and go back kind of slowly and then work back into it.
You still have to watch your diet. Yeah. I mean, because just because you're off doesn't mean you have to eat everything.
Right.
I mean, I ate today the ribeye steak, eggs, and cottage cheese. I mean, I don't know how to cheat on that diet. I do it all the time, and I think, oh, maybe I'll have something else. And I look at something else, no, I'm going back to the same old stuff.
Yeah.
But that's a habit.
Yeah. No, and by eating healthy, it affects your mood, too.
It does.
You always have a positive attitude. That's one of the things I really like about you. I've got to tell you. Is that you're always open to new ideas with a positive attitude.
Well, that's the only way to grow.
Yep.
I don't mean grow. I mean grow.
I understand.
Intellectually and forward in life.
And stay young.
Yeah, stay young. It's not the end of the world for me now. A lot of friends of mine a little younger than me are, have 1 foot in the grave. They just haven't been buried.
Right.
But there's always something new that comes up. I mean, I'm doing something live on Facebook now, which is new to me. And people are clicking on like right away, like 15, 16 views within 10 minutes.
I believe it.
So I found a thing there that I like to do, and it's live, it's personal, and it tells people what's going on. And they like it. I try to keep it professional with my studio, not just on a phone driving in a car. Hey, man, what's going on? You know, the people do that stuff, which to me is unprofessional.
Right.
But you want to give people something, even if it's free, you want to give them their money's worth.
Right.
You know?
Right, exactly.
And you want them to like it, and you want to give good product and good information. not fake news,
right?
As he'd say.
Now you asked me to think of stories or what happened back in world, characters back in World Gym in the 70s and 80s. I remember on a Sunday morning when Arnold brought Clint Eastwood in, and one of my favorite movies of all time was Dirty Harry. And here he was Sunday morning, and I wanted so much to run up and introduce myself and say hello, and it was very much unlike me not to do that, but I didn't do it. I was just too intimidated. But we saw everybody. I mean, Bertel Fox was, he was a monster. He could bench press 500 pounds and he'd for reps. And I would spot him, or he'd ask Mike Myers and me to hand him 120-pound dumbbells so he could do seated dumbbell presses.
Yeah, I remember those
days. You know what? Like, I once tore something in here rolling this thing up.
Just rolling it up.
That was great.
Well, we had a lot of celebrities. I mean, Isaac Hayes used to come in all golds, and Candace Bergen was on a mission for one of the networks doing a documentary, and she came in the gym one day. And she introduced herself. I knew who she was, but I didn't say I knew. I just knew. She says, "Do you mind if I take training pictures of you?" And she says, "Just disregard that I'm even in the building. I'm taking photos."
Right.
And I never saw them to this day. But I liked to have seen them. But people like that were coming in all the time.
Right.
And even when the 80s, when I went to Northridge Gold, Hulk Hogan was there, Chuck Norris, and all these guys would come in. But they were very approachable. Especially Hogan, since I was in the wrestling business.
Right.
And then Norris and I became friends because when I had hair and a headband, people would say, "You look like me." So I walked up and one day I said, "Chuck," and it was not, we knew each other, I said, "People think I look like you, but I'm looking at you, I'm much better looking."
You know, I syndicate him, so I work with him.
Yeah.
And he is phenomenal. He is the fountain of youth.
Yes, he is.
Because of his exercise and discipline.
And attitude.
And attitude and strong faith. I think that's very important,
good
especially
guy.
As you get older.
Yeah, he's a good guy.
Yeah.
So then we had lunch a few months ago.
Right.
And we talked about my book and what you wanted to do with it.
Mainly, most people don't know about it. I bet most people watching this didn't know that you wrote your memoirs, The Time of My Life. And it's on, go to Creators on the internet, Creator Syndicate, and look for publishing, and you'll see Rick Drayson, The Time of My Life, and it tells you all the different places you can buy it, like Amazon or...
Creatorsyndicate.com?
Yes.
Okay, I'll put that up there. It's a good book. It has a lot of stuff because I remember everything I've ever done. And everybody I ever dated, which is kind of weird. But I do remember these things, and I figured while I'm still, I got my brains together, I can write all this down. And the characters I met along the way on the road wrestling, and there was all kinds of stories and all kinds of people I ran into. And I was a musician. I played at the Hollywood Bowl and for Capitol Records, and that's a whole other life, which I did stuff. And then when I got into bodybuilding and wrestling, that's a whole other life again. And then recently in martial arts, I just went to Dragon Fest, and all my martial arts buddies are there. They're all starring in all those movies, and that's another world as well. So I've got four of those worlds going for me, and I wrote about them because it's not too often someone can do all that.
That's right. One of the things I noticed, this morning I reread the last chapter, and you talk about Randy saying, "Give up Rick's Corner. It'll never work."
Mm-hmm.
And then you talk about your mother going to Starbucks with her every day in the limited time before she passed away. And she said, "Do it. This is what you're meant to do." And look how successful, how right she was. But can you comment on that? Because everybody runs into friends and loved ones who say, "Don't, you'll never make it," versus, "Do it, you can."
There's a lot of negative people in this world that don't really want to see you make it because you've gotten out of you jumped through the window that they're still looking out at, and they don't want you to get away. It's like chasing a jackrabbit and you can't catch them. And when I was married, no disrespect to my wife at the time, but I don't think it ever should have been. I got a beautiful daughter out of it, but she never supported me on what I wanted to do. She always was jealous of my friends, my fans, and my talents, which I was born with a lot of talents, fortunately. My mom always backed me. My father died when I was 18. I went in the Army, came out, and then I got into wrestling, and he never had that journey with me, unfortunately. But when I started Rick's Corner, it was out in my garage, and my wife said, "What a dumb thing to do. No one's ever going to watch that." And a year later, I went to the World Gym Convention 2012, and I got the Lifetime Achievement Award, Jogo Lifetime Achievement Award, first time ever given, and I showed her. And I said on stage, a certain someone didn't believe in me, and this time I had like a million viewers. Mm-hmm. That's already years ago. And so now it's 28 million. And I told her about it. She says, "Well, I'm sure glad you didn't mention my name." I said, "Well, people know who I'm talking about." And my mom lived
here we are.
Yeah, my mom lived till 97, And she was a big supporter of mine. I would take her anytime I got a movie role or a commercial or anything I did, I'd always bring her on the set to meet everybody. And she always was very generous and kind, and people loved her. I'd take her to the gym, and she'd wait for me up front, and everybody would talk to her. And she'd always say, "Where are we going now, Rick?" I said, "We're going to go have coffee." "Okay, now where are we going?" "Then we're going to have lunch." She says, "Do you ever stop eating?" I said, "It's my routine. It's what I do. Just go with it." But she was very encouraging about what I did, and always look over my shoulder on the computer and see this. She didn't really know about this show at the time, except small bits about it, because she passed away before. But I know she would have been really proud about it, because it's just one more thing I could do. And in high school, I wasn't a big person about standing up in front of the class talking. It's like, I was shy. Not shy, but I didn't want to get up in front of people. I'd be the last one. Now you can put me in front of anybody and I'll talk, because I learned over the years how to have the self-confidence and project yourself and be positive about it and make a statement and do the right thing. And I think it really helped a long way. As you can see, I'm still talking.
So. Yeah, no, I think that's great. And you know, I remember Franco Columbo told me that they used to get a kick out of it when you started wrestling.
Yeah.
And you would tell them to come to certain meets,
right?
And because they, you knew you were going to win that night.
Right.
And so that makes everybody think, okay, there's a designated winner and a designated loser, therefore it's all fake.
Right.
But you address that in your book. It's not fake. I mean, explain how it's not fake and it is fake.
Or... Well, wrestling, I like to call it ballet with violence. It's a dance. And like stunt work, you have to know the moves, you have to know what to do. Everybody is trained basically the same way, with different holds that interlock into something else, like a side headlock, into a top wrist lock, into a smack or a snapmare. And you kind of just go with the flow. And then when I was working with a lot of the Mexican wrestlers from Mexico, they didn't speak English. But they knew what to do, and I knew what to do. If they didn't go, you'd pull them a little bit. Well, you had those with attitudes that didn't want to work with you, and they'd get stiff, and they'd smack you in the nose, and you'd tell them, you know, I know one accident's okay, next time you're getting it back, and you hit them really hard, and then that would be the end of it. So there is a lot of danger involved. The holds are real. Every one of those are real, and you could really hurt somebody in self-defense on the street. And when you're used to wrestling every day, guys bigger than you and all over the place, you're so used to grabbing and moving and grabbing and moving that on the street, if you want to grab somebody, they grab you. You can just defend yourself just like that. The finish is predetermined, because that's what sells tickets, like a movie, you know, a false ending into a new ending, and then people come back to see another match, just like with boxing, like this fight coming up Saturday. You just have to work the audience. It's crowd psychology, leading them through a journey of beginning, middle, and ending, and at the last one, when they think it's going to end, you switch it on them. But the hold's real, and you do fall. When you're falling out of that ring, you're falling. When you get hit with a chair, you're getting hit with a chair. I've had so many pulled muscles and teeth knocked out and ripped tendons, it's not fun.
No. Yeah,
but
I believe it.
It's not fun, but here I am.
So,
the
so
super glue.
With the bodybuilding.
Yeah.
Tell us about it in the 60s. When you who started Gold's Gym first, you or Arnold Schwarzenegger?
All right, here's what happened. I grew up in Bakersfield,
right.
And I trained at the YMCA, which is a very, very small gym. Minimal weights, but I started getting in really good shape. In 65, I entered into pro wrestling, living up there, meeting some wrestlers who came to town. I'd drive down to the Olympic Auditorium. I got to meet people in L.A., which is where I wanted to live. Once I moved down here, I went to Bill Pearl's gym. And Bill Pearl was, he was the man, Mr. America, that had the body. And it was in the middle of Inglewood, which is pretty much Watts. It's not a great area, but I learned a lot and trained hard. And someone said, "Why don't you go to Gold's Gym?" I said, "I've never heard of Gold's Gym. I didn't know it existed in Venice. I had no clue, but I did like Santa Monica." So I went over there one day, and I ran into Arnold the first day and a couple of the guys, and we started talking, and we started training on bench presses, which I like and I was good at. And one thing led to another. The next day we did some more. And so I moved from Torrance to Santa Monica. I remember the apartment, 10th and Wilshire, right in the middle of everything, for $135 a month, which is like really cheap. It's about $3,000 a month now. And we just started training together. And what happened was, and people don't know this, and I've said this before, Joe Gold owned the gym. Joe Gold was a bodybuilder. Joe Gold was on the road with Mae West on her tours and troops through Vegas. He was a stuntman. He was a wrestler. He was a background player, and he was well known. His buddies like Seymour Koenig and some of these other guys were all worked with him in the movie. Steve Merjanian, who was a strong guy. The gym was $40 a year, and it wasn't very well known. And then Weider comes down one day, and he decides to take training pictures of Arnold and Draper and the guys and puts them in his magazine. He had Draper first, actually. Draper was the first guy. Well, the magazine circulates around the world, and these people in bodybuilding look at the magazine and say, "Oh, my God, Gold's Gym is the place to go. Everybody's there." They didn't realize it's the size of a postage stamp. Yeah. It was small. But it had a charisma and atmosphere that you could never duplicate. So the gym started to become famous, like really famous. And then Joe just got tired of it, and he sold it to two guys, Bud Danitz and Dave Sachs, and they ran it for a year, and they painted it inside red, white, and blue, like 70s style. They got tired of it and they sold it to Ken Sprague. And Ken turned it into a type of a gym that would sponsor bodybuilding shows, and it started to take off. And then they came to me, Ken Waller and Arnold and Ken, said, look, they knew I would doodle on napkins when we go eat. I'm always drawing cartoons. They said, can you draw a cartoon for the gym or a logo? I said, yeah. What do you want? And Ken Waller said, how about Mr. Clean? I said, well, this is probably what I'll look like one day when I shave my head, so I'll do that. And I drew the barbell with a bald-headed guy. They printed a dozen shirts. They sold out the first day. They printed another 144. They sold out, and it became the largest iconic logo in the world.
That is amazing. That is amazing.
Done on a napkin in Zookie's Deli. Okay, I had no visions of it. It was a favor, and I thought, okay, this is cool. I got my shirt, and it's got my name on it. It's Gold's Gym. And then 2 years later in 76, 3 years later in 76, Joe Gold decided to open up World Gym. He was a merchant marine. He came back to the California. He says, I want my gym back, but he sold his name. So he opened up World Gym at 2210 Main Street, upstairs. He came to me, he says, Rick, I need a logo. I said, what do you want? He said, I have no clue. So I drew up some things. No, that's not. He says, what about a gorilla? I said, yeah, I can draw a gorilla. So I drew the gorilla sitting on the world front and back with the butt cheeks that were exposed. And those circles on those cheeks were made out of two dimes. I drew circles around them. Mm-hmm. And I put my name right under the ass. Those shirts sold like hotcakes as well. So now I'm married to both gyms by way of the logos, Gold's and World. So if I wore a Gold's shirt in World Gym, they're not crazy about it, but they know I did it. And if I wore a World Gym in Gold's Gym, they say, well, how come? Because I did both logos.
You know, when I was at World Gym, I remember there was Big Steve, who was an artist.
Steve Cipello, Steve Strong.
He had wrestled with Jesse Ventura.
Right.
Tag team partner.
Right.
And I always thought he painted the World Gym logo. But I found out later you created it. He painted it.
He painted it on a wall.
On the wall.
Yeah.
Okay.
He's a good artist.
Great artist.
I have some oil paintings of his now. He wrestled with Steve Strong as Hulk Hogan's partner, and then he retired from that. He's still a painter. He drew a huge, huge picture of Jesse Ventura when he became governor,
right,
and that unveiled it. Just a beautiful job. This guy's really top-notch painter.
Yeah, he was always very, very nice in the gym.
Oh, real nice guy. I worked with him on Channel 52, wrestling with him, and he lives in Topanga Canyon as a hippie,
right,
missing teeth, and he doesn't care. He says, if I didn't bring my stuff to the table by the time of 40 and become a millionaire, it's never going to happen. It's exactly the words he told me, and he's happy living in the jungle up there in Topanga Canyon, like one of the hippies in painting, and that's what he likes.
Right. When I first joined World, I came in, first of all, it was like 4:30 in the morning, because I was terrified to walk into this gym, so I figured nobody would be there. And I walk up the stairs feeling like I'm voluntarily going into San Quentin, because I didn't know. And there's one guy there, Steve Merjanian.
Yep.
And he's warming up with incline bench presses with 315.
Yep.
So I thought, oh, everybody does that here. I thought, maybe it's not the right place. He was so kind and so nurturing and so great. And I wrote him a check, $150 for a year. Now, when I hear people, they join SoulCycle, and they pay $75 for a workout.
I know. I can't get Steve on the show. He doesn't want to be on camera.
He should. He's so knowledgeable.
I know. He was going to do it, and then he said, nope, I can't, for whatever reason.
He's a really good man of great character.
He was doing tricep extensions of 300 pounds.
I believe it. Bertel Fox did that, too. Tricep press.
No, I'm talking about the bar. And then Steve hung out with Chuck Ahrens.
Yeah.
Remember Chuck Ahrens?
I know, yes.
Chuck was one of the strongest men alive. He was huge, and he wasn't all there. And he'd drive around and drink milk and throw it in the back seat of his car, the cartons, and he got pulled over one day for obstruction of vision because he couldn't see through the milk cartons in the car. So four sailors are in some driving, like a Stan's driving, and they're giving him a hard time. And so he went and ripped their door handles off, and they locked the doors. And so they went to leave, and he picked the car up from behind, and the wheels were just spinning. That's how strong he was.
Wow.
But he and Steve were best buddies, and they trained hard together.
Right.
I ran into Chuck maybe 10 years ago up on a deli. He was sweeping up a warehouse. I said, Chuck Ahrens. And the first thing he said to me was, I lost 80 pounds. First thing that came out of his head. And then he passed away a year later from, I'm not quite sure what it was.
That's terrible.
But those were characters.
They were. And Joe Gold was a character.
Yes, he was.
I was at the York Barbell has a museum. And my wife and I stopped by there about 2 months ago, and I couldn't believe it. And they have a Hall of Fame for bodybuilding, and they have Joe Gold.
I'm sure.
I was very proud of him. But I was thinking of all the stories. Like, after I had paid that $150 check, I'm there working out on a Saturday, and Joe Gold comes up to me, and there were, 30 people in the gym. And it's a very small room. I mean, now it's a private house. And he says, hey, did you pay And I said, I did. I paid $150 to Steve early in the morning. And he said, oh, that's right. So then Bugsy, who I did, it's the first time I met Bugsy.
Another character.
Red face, great guy. Comes running up, says, oh, Joe, you'd be the perfect landlord. You know, you hassle the tenants, they pay their rent, you give them hell. And Bugsy was with Jan Friedman, another really good guy. There were so many good people.
You have to know Bugsy to believe Bugsy. Actually, I have a picture I can throw up. He looked like a Chicago gangster. He had a Cadillac convertible, and he talked me into buying one for whatever reason.
But he had a heart of gold.
Heart of gold. He'd come to the gym, and he got opened his trunk and drink a quart of milk with a pint of vodka before he trained.
Right. And then his face was so red.
Yeah, all red. And then he'd get down the bench press, and he had a switch it on, reversed. He'd do a bench press, and it'd be one arm going up, and then the other arm. One arm bench presses. And then he'd make fun and yell at people in the gym, make fun of them all. But he was a good guy. He was funny as hell.
He was.
He could have been a stand-up comic.
He was.
Those days are gone. They're not around anymore like that, unfortunately. But it's in my book. I talk about all these guys.
I love your book. How about being the partial Hulk? That's a great part. Bill Bixby was the doctor.
Yeah.
And Dr. David Banfield.
Banner.
And then there's Lou Ferrigno, who's the green Incredible Hulk. Well, in between, when you go from Bixby to Ferrigno, there is Rick Drayson.
Yeah, Lou came in the gym one day and said, they're looking for a middle Hulk, a demi Hulk, and you look enough like me and Bill that you should go do it. So I went and met the producer, and he says, yeah, you're perfect. Well, you've got the role. And so they put makeup on me, made me brown, then they made me green. They couldn't find the right color. But I have pictures I can load up on this as well. And it worked, and now it's got a huge following. I just did an interview about that in London just last week.
I believe it.
I should probably do Comic-Con and sell pictures. I might make $20.
I don't mean to be rude. I'm just looking for chapter titles.
Yeah.
So to give you ideas, things you want to talk about.
Well, there's a lot of things on. The making of a pro wrestler is talked about how I trained for that, and it was against all odds because my family didn't want me to go into wrestling. It's not something you pick to do. My friends hated it in Bakersfield. Why can't you just sell cars like we do here? And so I fought that, and I stuck to my guns and what I wanted to do. I promoted wrestling shows here in L.A. at schools, and I drew 500-600 people. They don't do that anymore today. They're about like 30, 40 people, but I did it right. Oh, my God.
Let me tell you, one of the things that really, probably the most impressive thing about you and your life is your family.
Yeah.
Because at the very end of the book, you see this fabulous picture of Rick with Ina and your children and your grandchildren.
Oh, all of them outside by my ring, yeah.
Yeah, it's fantastic.
Yeah, it's fun.
Because that's, if you can do that, nothing else counts.
No, it all adds up at the end of the day. But some of these things, this is my diet and training program, how there's backstabbing and wrestling, like with acting, everybody gets ahead by belittling somebody else, which I don't believe in. Wrestling as an aerobic workout in the ring, running ropes and doing tumbles is a great way to burn body fat. And there's all kinds of stuff like that. The training for the pro wrestling was really hard. It's like MMA today. I mean, I don't think I could do it today at my age, but I sure did it then. And you asked me, what is a mark? A mark is a fan that sits ringside and believes everything he sees and wants to rub shoulders with him because he's just like, you're a wrestler, you know, or you're a bodybuilder. They're all around.
I remember when my son, who's 35 now, was about 12, and we went down to Orange County for some, at that time it was WWF, McMahon promotion, and they had a character, The Undertaker.
Yes.
And some other character, I can't remember who, had a chair, and he hit him, and we were like right there, and I thought, whoa, he really hit him. That would have hurt.
You hit with the flat of the chair, but it definitely jars you around. There's something here about breaking into films, which was a big question years ago. My first marriage, I was bodybuilding, of course, and I was wrestling, and I told my father-in-law at the time I wanted to be an actor. He said, actors are no good. None of them ever work. I see him at the YMCA all day long. I said, well, it's not going to stop me from doing it. I'm going to give it a shot. And so then I got a commercial for Chevy with Arnold and with some guys, Charlie Faust and those guys, and then I got the movie Ben, where I played a gym instructor attacked by rats. And then I got the FBI series as a gangster, and then it went on from there, and then the Hulk, and then lots of beer commercials. So I made enough in acting over the years to take my retirement and also get my medical for free. So I proved them wrong, saying that if you really want it bad enough, you can do it. Yes, acting's tough, wrestling's tough. It's not easy to get into anything like that today, but if you have the drive and you really want to do it, you'll find a way. And I just said something about somebody who says, well, you have to want it bad enough. Well, someone will say, okay, I want it bad enough. No, you don't. You're saying you want it bad enough, but how bad do you really want it? You got to put yourself out for it. It's like training in the gym. You want it bad enough, you got to bust your ass. It's not going to come to you easy. And that's what it follows through with everything in life.
What do you think about the fact that so many of the bodybuilders today just take huge quantities of chemicals.
I don't like it.
And they don't look, they have big size.
Yeah.
Period. There's no form, there's no symmetry,
no.
There's no shape.
There's no shape. You can line them all up, they all look the same. You line all of us guys back up in the 70s with silhouettes, I've said this, you can tell everybody's different.
You're right.
The thing is with the chemicals, I mean, anything can hurt you. You can overdose on aspirin. The model died on water. Anything you take it to extreme, coffee, whatever, it's not good for you. And the same thing with steroids. There are certain steroids that you take as you get older, like testosterone, because your body doesn't produce it, or women with estrogen, but you don't have to go to the extreme of insulin, synthol, and all these other chemicals that blow you out of proportion because it's hard on your heart.
Yeah.
And your heart can only take so much, and then one day that's it, it bursts, and that's it. And for what? Just to be big?
Yeah.
And I've seen two guys that get huge, like 300 pounds, and one guy down in Venice, he's like 150 now. He lost it all.
Yeah.
And being sick doesn't look like the same person at all. And so you had your 15 minutes of fame, now what?
I think a lot of the people who get instant muscle from chemicals don't keep training later in life.
No.
Guys like you and me who trained really hard when we were young
are
still training really hard in our 60s and 70s and plan to in the 80s. Bob Paris, he was another one. Very smart guy.
Yeah.
I always liked and respected Bob a lot.
Yeah, he was always in good shape. But it's funny because I go to the gym. I went with my daughter this morning and we worked out just the circuit workout. I go and I train hard. I separate my body parts. I don't do as much dumbbells and barbells and mostly machines, but it's the same resistance. And I still stay in shape. So somebody said to me, I got on the scale and they were shocked what I weighed. I said, well, what'd you think I weigh? The guy says, I thought maybe 190, 185. And the girl says, I don't know, 180. That's 215. Where do you put 215? I said, I'm thick. I have a lot of muscle on me. And I've always been 215. I dropped down out of the hospital 197. I look like I'm going to die.
Right.
So I put more back on. Not fat, but muscle.
You know, they have new studies that are showing that when you do a lot of weightlifting, you increase your bone density.
Oh, yeah?
The bone mass. And it becomes heavier. That's part of what makes you weigh more.
Okay.
It's not just muscle, it's bone.
Yeah.
I'll give you an example. I had terrible shoulder injuries, which came from heavy weightlifting for years and years. And when I was 50, my shoulder, I had a rotator cuff tear. It took about 5 years. When I was 55, I finally, had been back training and I popped it again. When I was 60, a third time, I discovered a book by Dr. John Kirsch, an orthopedic surgeon in Wisconsin, who said if you hang from a bar,
you told me this,
and you keep hanging, he explained it to me. I flew to Chicago. We met in Chicago at his daughter's apartment, and then went to a Cubs game. And while we were talking, I said he was explaining how this subacromium arch does this, and Julius Wolf, the physicist, explains how your bones can get molded with pressure and weight. And as he explained it all, I said to him, let me try to play it back to you, so if I ever have to explain this to people, tell me if this layman thing is correct. He said, okay. And he said, this is correct. If this is your rotator cuff, this is what's called the CA arch, and it's gently curved. And you see how there's space between the two. What happens when you do a lot of dips and heavy bench presses, this becomes hooked, and it impinges on the rotator cuff.
I know exactly what you mean.
So it feels, some people get frozen shoulder, or other people get where it's just, you can't, you know the old thing when, don't lift weights, you won't be able to comb your hair.
Right.
Well, that's why, because of that.
It's like a doorstop.
Right.
Pretty much.
So he said when you get shoulder surgery, the surgeon goes in and cuts off this bone, they saw it off, and that creates the room. See that?
Yeah, I know.
But if you hang, you gradually straighten out the CA arch, so it becomes curved instead of hooked, and you create the room yourself.
I like that. I remember you telling me this a long time ago.
It is absolutely fabulous. The other thing I recommended was the Legacy of Iron books by Brooks Kubik. I don't know if you've read those, but I love those. The stories about John Grimmick and Steve Stanko.
Oh, sure.
And, the original weightlifters and bodybuilders.
They were the best. They don't make them like that anymore.
No.
So where can we get my book?
Go to creators.com or creatorsyndicate.com, creators.com, and go to publishing, and you'll see all books. We have like 200 titles, and yours is there, featured prominently. You just click on it, The Time of My Life by Rick Drayson, and then it'll you can go either to Amazon or to
I think Amazon, iTunes. Google, iTunes, and Barnes & Noble.
Barnes & Noble, yeah.
That's awesome.
It's a great book. I highly recommend it.
We got to do more. We got to do bodybuilding for dumbbells.
I love it.
I think we should do it.
Yeah.
Okay. Well, I want to thank you for being here.
Thank you.
if you have any more to add, if they want to publish something, they can reach you through me.
Absolutely.
Or is there a direct email?
No, it's better. They go through you. And
okay.
Then,
okay.
The other thing I'll say, I told Mike Myers and Jack Yee, I said, do you guys remember some of those names from World Gym back in the 70s and 80s? Because I don't always remember. I know who they are, but I just don't always remember the names. And they said, oh, my gosh, I'm so impressed. You're going to meet Rick Drayson. You're going to be on his show. I said, oh, yeah.
Oh, yeah.
So you're like becoming a legend.
I know.
One is in Massachusetts. The other's in New York.
You know, and I stay humble with it, and I appreciate it. It's difficult because when I go out, wherever I go, I get stopped by people all the time.
I believe it.
And it's flattering, and I love to talk to people, and it's fun. I go to restaurants, and the managers know me, and I get discounts, and I get this and that. And I'm always, it's just the way my life works, and it's gotten better with age, and it has not stopped. It just keeps escalating more and more. Of course, the more shows I do, the more people see it. So it's all a good thing, and I like people, and I love you guys, your fans, you're awesome. And I just keep putting this out here. I mean, I don't do Risk Corner to make money. I mean, I have things I sell, but it's not, it's more of a passion of love to do this show. And I got to do it because it's going to pay my bills, because it doesn't.
Yeah.
You know, I have other people paying my bills. No, I'm kidding. Thanks, Rick.
Thank you, Rick.
I really enjoyed this, and I hope you guys enjoyed this. A lot of information here. And write in and tell us what you like, because maybe we can do a follow-up with more stuff as well. We'll come up with more ideas and more characters we can pull out of their graves. I'd love to get these people on the show, but some of them are dead and some don't talk. But we'll do more. Thanks for watching Rick's Corner, and we'll see you all next time.
He is the equalizer, baby. See you next time.